Hello and a very warm welcome to the brand new edition of Policy Watch. I'm Kriti Mishra. The Union Cabinet has approved the Major Ports Authority Bill 2020, which will be introduced in the ongoing session of Parliament. It seeks to provide greater autonomy and flexibility to major ports. The bill seeks to repeal the Major Port Trusts Act 1963. The bill was first tabled in Parliament in 2016, but members then sought a review from the Parliamentary Standing Committee before enactment. India has 12 major ports. The total coastal cargo traffic handled by Indian ports in 2018-19 was 262.56 million tons, which was 12.68% more than the coastal cargo traffic of 233.02 million tons in fiscal year 2017-18. And to get deeper insights on the bill, I'm joined by Mr. Rabinder Agarwal, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Shipping, Mr. Chakshu Roy, Head of Outreach, PRS Legislative Research, and Dr. P.K. Ghosh, Shipping Expert. Welcome to Ratsabha Television, all of you. Mr. Agarwal, let me come to you first. Take us through the crucial highlights of the Major Ports Authority Bill 2020.
Yes, Major Ports Authority Bill 2020, as you know, which was passed by the Cabinet a couple of days back. The most important aspect of this bill is that it aims to provide more functional autonomy and operational independence to the port authorities. You would know that the ports operate on a very competitive environment, and we need to empower the ports so that they take commercial decisions without being restricted by governmental controls. And to that extent, this bill intends to give operational autonomy to the ports. Now, the most important things, if you had to ask me, I would list out three, four major points that is incorporated in this bill. First of all is the structure of the board of the port. So in the present Major Port Trust Act 1963, the board's strength is about 17 to 19, and it is represented by various interest groups. Now we have tried to make it a much leaner board with 11 to 13 members. And there is a provision to have four independent members, and it is expected that with their expertise they will bring to the table, and it will help in the governance of the port. In addition to those four independent members, we have two representatives from the labor unions, then representative of Ministry of Defense, Customs, Railways, one government nominee, and the chairman of the port is obviously the chairman of the board also. So this is a much leaner board. Secondly, unlike the private ports, the major ports had a regulated regime in terms of fixation of tariff and scale of rates. Now with this act, this bill, we are deregulating the major ports in the sense that the tariff being charged by the public-private partnership projects, the operators, they'll be free to fix tariffs as per the market condition. And the other scale of rates that is required to be fixed by the port, which was earlier done by Tariff Authority of Major Ports, will be done henceforth by the port authorities themselves. In addition to that, we have given a lot of operational autonomy in the sense that the ports will be free to enter into contracts, which otherwise in the earlier regime, they were to take the government approval. They have the freedom to make master plan. They have to take decision on the development operation of the ports. Earlier on, all the regulations of the port for operation, day-to-day operations, were to be approved by Government of India. In this dispensation, the power to make regulation is now completely vested with the port authorities. Government will be making rules only. So this, I think, would be few points which kind of distinguishes it very comprehensively from the Major Port Trust Act 1963. In this act, we have also brought in the adjudicatory board, which was earlier, it was not there. This adjudicatory board will take over the residual function of the Tariff Authority of Major Ports, and it will also be looking into the disputes that might arise between the port authorities and the PPP operators. The adjudicatory board is also entrusted with the task of review of the stressed projects. Some of the PPP projects get stressed because of certain situations arising in the market. And then they can also look into the complaints. They can make suggestions for review of the projects. in the port sector. So this is a new provision which was not there, and we anticipate that with the introduction of adjudicatory board, some of the problems of PPP projects, which otherwise used to be, you know, taking a lot of time for their resolution, will get expedited. So this is again a very important provision in the
bill. All right, sir. So those were the broad contours. But Chakshu, I'd like to understand that this bill was tabled in Parliament in 2016. What are the amendments based on the recommendations of the Parliamentary Standing Committee that have been incorporated in the bill?
Kriti, you know, if you look at the legislative journey on this particular subject, the first piece of legislation for major ports came out in the 1960s, five decades ago. You know, it defined major ports within the bill, and it said, you know, this is the list of the major ports. That list with, you know, central government's notification was added. And as in your opening remarks, you mentioned that there are 12 of them now. Now, you know, following Mr. Agarwal's comments, you know, the legislative journey was in 2016, the bill got introduced in Lok Sabha. The bill was referred to a parliamentary standing committee, and the standing committee came up with a number of recommendations. In fact, one of the recommendations that, you know, they suggested was a representation for labor onto the newly constituted board, and that is something that Mr. Agarwal said, you know, will be there in the upcoming bill. Now, one of the things that happened was, after the standing committee, the process in parliament is a bill gets introduced, it goes in for details, you know, scrutiny to a specialized standing committee. The standing committee hears people's out, it gets the ministry on board, it gets different stakeholder board on board. And based on their comments, it suggests certain recommendations. The government then is free to accept those recommendations or reject them. In many cases, what we have seen is that the recommendations of parliamentary standing committees are accepted to a large extent. But while all of this parliamentary process was on, the term of the, you know, the Lok Sabha finished. And as our constitution provides, whenever the term of a Lok Sabha finishes and the bill was pending in, you know, Lok Sabha, that bill lapses. So the administrative process for, you know, reigniting that bill has started again. And the first part of that thing is that it needs to be approved by the cabinet. Cabinet has given its approval, and now when the parliament session starts on the 2nd of March, the bill will be introduced. When the bill gets introduced, all of us will have access to the nuances of the bill. Now, we are hoping that, you know, some of the recommendations that were given by the committee, you know, will be incorporated. But we'll have to wait for the bill to be actually introduced to get into the deeper details of the bill. But I think what will be good to discuss today is what is that major policy shift that we are trying to achieve from a five-decade ago, you know, law to the current one. Mr. Agarwal pointed out, and, you know, Mr. Ghosh will also point out, as to the landscape of shipping has completely transformed in this 50 years. There's that much more competition within ports. Ports need a lot more autonomy to their working. And one question when it comes to autonomy was that under the current regime of the 1963 law, there are board of trusts. So every major, you know, port has a board of trust. But that board of trust is, you know, functionally dependent on the central government to, you know, give them directions on certain things. Now, whether it is related to contracts, whether it is related to day-to-day operations. Now, what that means is that, you know, in the functioning, in their functioning, they are not as free as they would like to be. And when you're running a massive operation like a port, which is handling, you know, millions of tons of cargo, you need to be able to make decisions on your own, keeping in your mind your specific requirements as a port, the kind of cargo that you're handling, the kind of ships that you're handling. So that is, you know, changing. The other part of it is, you know, while you get functional autonomy as a regulator of a port, you know, what are the kind of things that you should be looking at? In your opening remarks, you know, I heard a sense of the fact as to, are we going to follow the same model of running ports as was done in the 1960s, or are we going to look at a newer model? Right. The world has kind of moved on to a slightly newer model of port administration, where there is an authority which, you know, owns the assets of the port, you know, the land and, you know, other things, and acts as a regulator. But the day-to-day running of port operations, you know, getting cargo off the ship, servicing of ships, providing them with power, is then left to, you know, private entities or individuals who are, specialized in their particular aspect of it. And that then means as to, you know, if I am a private, you know, player, you know, unloading cargo from a ship, how much money should I be able to charge? Is that competitive? You know, I should not be shutting other people out. What if I don't do my job? What if I don't pay my dues? So the port will be restricted to, you know, owning things and basically being the regulator, while day-to-day specialized operations will be done by people who are equipped to deal with that. So that's a shift that we are making, you know, from 50 years ago to now. Is that shift necessary in the changing environment where people are getting specialized? The port's regulator has a specialized function of ensuring that the port operates optimally. But should it be worried about ki, you know, today this ship has gotten stranded and it is facing difficulties? Maybe not so much, right? I mean, that can be left to other players.
Of course, you're talking about the global best practices, and I'll take that to Dr. Ghosh. Dr. Ghosh, the bill seeks to reorient the governance model to landlord port model. Help us understand this landlord port model.
First, let me mention that, there was an increasing sense in the shipping industry and in the port authorities that the major ports had become some sort of monoliths, which were calcified in the sense that they couldn't compete with the 200 odd minor ports and the number of private players that had come in. To give you a sense, the Mundra and the Pipavav, they came about third and fourth, while the major ports came much down below. In 2017 or so, the minor ports developed at the rate of 16%, while the major ports developed at a meager rate of 3%. Now, this is the rate at which development took place. So this bill, which was supposed to come up at that time, 2016, unfortunately, it was one of the biggest infrastructural, initiatives that were taken by the government to change the entire landscape of maritime commerce. But it got stuck due to what Mr. Roy had said. And of course, they've given the details of the bill, so I'm not going to go over to that. Then, unfortunately, there was a lot of opposition to this sort of a bill. And if I may say, the unions opposed it. Any change is always opposed. And they felt that this was a backdoor entry for privatization. Now, you must remember, many of these problems have been addressed. And even on the board, you've got about 3 to 4 members from the unions and independent people who are going to be part of the board. So that will offset all this. One important point, I think, which was sort of missed out before I come to the landlord thing, was that now the board has got the financial, not only to set the tariffs, which is, of course, the bill agrees that tariff was one of the most major things. Yes. You could never compete in the market. So that is why you got to set your own tariffs, which the private ports did. In fact, they provided customized services, which they were too rigid to provide all these customized services. So they lost out. Anyway, so the one thing is they can raise loans. Now, they can raise loans up to, I think, 50% of the capital assets of the port. Beyond that, they've got to go to the central government. But other than that, earlier, they would have to, for the smallest, if they're not the head, they had to go to the central government, which is no longer, that flexibility has been given. Now, coming to the landlord model, which was, that was the original. Now, the landlord model was in which the port would not only own all the assets, but also look into the services being provided. The service model, on the other hand, was that, why, and this is what has come into the bill now, that the ports keep owning. The board owns the land, they own all the assets. But as Mr. Roy said, now the shift is towards providing offsetting, if I may use. In defense, we use the term offset. So it's been out, it's been offset to the extent that it has been handed over to a private company to take over all the specialized services, which, and the revenue model, the revenue generated can be decided by the port, by the board itself. So obviously, this is a much more agreeable, this is a much more forward-looking, and I probably would use the term revolutionary change as far as we are concerned.
Absolutely. So it's a forward-looking bill. But Mr. Agarwal, we're talking about more flexibility and autonomy. But Indian Ship Owners Association have expressed concern, and they said that it is about the effective implementation. How do you plan to ensure that the bill is effectively implemented?
See, this bill provides a legal framework for the shift towards the landlord model of port development. As the two speakers have already stated, the service model of port basically entitled port to own the assets and to have the operations also. But in this scenario, the port assets are owned by the port authority. The major infrastructure like the breakwater, the navigation channel, all these things are developed by the port authorities. And the terminal operation where the commercial decisions are taken on day-to-day basis is bid out to the private sector on a revenue share or royalty model. So, and it is not that we do not have such things in our ports. We already have a semblance of, you know, landlord model in the ports. Like, if you were to see Ennore port, if you were to see JNPT, we already have, you know, terminal being operated by the private sector. This bill provides more stable, more concrete provisions wherein this model of port development is going to be facilitated. As Dr. Ghosh said, you know, the financial powers. Earlier on, if a port were to invest on equity in some other projects, there was government approval was required. In order to raise loan, government approval was required. For entering into contracts, government approval was required. In fact, I should say that in the Major Port Trust Act 1963, there were 34 occasions on which the port trust were to take government approval. Now it has been brought down to only 8. So these are the provisions which will facilitate the port to operate on a much competitive environment. You know that the ports are, I mean, major ports are mentioned in the union list, schedule 7, and the non-major ports are in the concurrent list. So port development is a concurrent jurisdiction. So the ports under the administrative control of Government of India are called major ports just because it is governed under the Major Port Trust Act. And all other ports in the state sector are non-major ports. And you would know that there was no regulation as far as fixation of tariff was concerned for the non-major port, but major ports were having this fixed tariff regime over the entire period of concession, and that brought in a lot of rigidity, you know, in negotiating as per the market condition. So I would say this bill provides a framework wherein the port trusts will undertake their journey from service port to the landlord port development model much more smoothly. Now, as far as the labor trustees are concerned, Dr. Ghosh also mentioned that we have brought in the provision. We do understand the role of labor in the operations of the port. And therefore, we have made provision that labor representatives will be there in the board, in the refined board of port authorities. Then the service conditions of the existing employees, the pensionary benefits of those who have retired from the ports, those have been retained, you know. And while drafting this bill, the journey had started, you know, I mean, 2016, the bill was introduced in Parliament, but the journey started much before, you know.
Yes.
There have been various rounds of consultations with labor federations, the stakeholders, and again, after 2016, once it was introduced, it was referred to the Parliamentary Standing Committee. The committee went around the country, they took evidence, they interacted with various stakeholders, and they submitted the recommendation those recommendations were again considered by the ministry, and quite a number of recommendations were accepted. And only because we accepted some of the recommendations, therefore we also introduced what is called official amendments to Major Port Authorities Bill 2016. But as the legislative business is, you know, because the 16th Lok Sabha could not, you know, deliberate on this, and when the term got over, the bill lapsed. And the parliamentary affairs procedure states that you have to start the process all over again. And that is how this bill was put up for a stakeholder consultation, and then we went to the cabinet for seeking approval so as to reintroduce the bill in the parliament. So I would say implementation will not be a problem just because of the fact that the bill is a product of widespread consultation and accommodating the views of many stakeholders. Many genuine views of the stakeholders has been incorporated in the bill. This is the best model, globally accepted model of landlord development model, wherein the commercial operations are left to the wisdom of the professionals, where they do marketing, they attract cargo, and they handle more and more commodities, they bring in more equipments, managerial capabilities, and the port assets are owned by the port authority. The major infrastructure, which involves huge investment, upfront investment, and lot of, you know, risks elements, and that is why the port authorities would own the asset and develop those major infrastructure, which is common for all the terminals. You see, when a breakwater is constructed,
yes,
this is not, you know, appropriated or used by a particular terminal. It will be used by all the terminal which is operating there. The main navigation channel, which is required for a ship to come to the port, this is used by everybody.
Right.
Therefore, this core infrastructure is developed. And this is the best model of port development as we see today.
And of course, you've said that after wider deliberations, all the concerns of the stakeholders have been addressed by the government. But Chakshu, how will this proposed legislation enhance the competitiveness of our port sector?
Okay. Kriti, let's look at two different scenarios. Let's look at a scenario where ports continue to work in the existing way they are working, where they have limited operational maneuverability, there is limited scope for dispute resolution, where there is limited working, the working of the port is constrained because of raising of finances. Many of those things are addressed. So, for example, you know, you were talking about ship owners. I'm not an expert, but you know, one of the provisions of the 2016 bill was that it was setting up an adjudication authority.
Yes.
And that adjudication authority was going to, you know, take care of any disputes between, you know, two private players who were operating in the port, or between people who were using the port and the port trust or port authority, and any other dispute that might come up for place. Now, in all cases, the proof of the pudding will always be in the eating. So, you know, how the port will operate, the ports are already operating. This
yes.
is a new layer of, you know, administrative functioning that will come into play. But I think the idea would be to measure, you know, how ports are doing, right? So, if you look at some of the existing parameters of ports, turnaround time for vessels, unloading of cargo, total amount of cargo that has been handled. Some of that will depend on the regulatory part of it. Some of that will depend on, you know, global trade, the kind of, you know, facilities we
yes.
can offer, the competitiveness of rates, you know, that our ports offer. Now, when this new piece of legislation kicks into place, let's say competitiveness of tariff, right? That, you know, there's a board, there's going to be a governing authority that will be able to look at the tariff and say, oh, you know what? Is this profitable for us? Is this not profitable for us? And what is it that we can do here?
Absolutely. So there would be a variety of factors at play. But I have last 30 seconds on the show, Dr. Kosh. How will this proposed legislation enhance the efficiency, the overall efficiency, and lead to port-led development as envisaged by the government?
See, I'll put it this way. It provides you the impetus. It provides you with the flexibility. Now it's up to the people over there the board, the workers, and all the stakeholders, including the private parties, who are going to be involved in this, to utilize this, the bill and whatever is available. So it is up to them. Earlier, they were restrained because the tariffs were high, it was not competitive, the turnaround times were high, and there was an overall sense of lethargy. So now it's up to them. If you want to improve, what's stopping you? I think that's the best answer.
Absolutely. So the onus is on all the stakeholders. On that note, thank you so much for joining us. So it is one of the biggest structural reforms of the major ports in India in more than 5 decades. That's all we have for you in this edition of Policy Watch. Thanks for watching and stay tuned to Rajya Sabha Television.